Quality Growth Steering Committee, because the market had turned around. Now we're in a boom phase. Suburbs are leapfrogging out into the communities where we have, we're not controlling the growth, not managing the growth as good as we could, taking everything into consideration. Big concern, we were starting to have some air quality problems. We're in a big long valley, traps the air, we get inversions. We were in non-conformance for some of the pollution characteristics, so we were dealing with that. So people are talking about quality of life a lot more. How do we, it's not so great to have mountains if you can't see them. It's, if you can't get up and down the mountains to go to the ski areas. We call it the red snake. Going up in the morning and coming down at night, it's just you see brake lights all the way over. And this group was again made up of public and private sector participants. And I think, you know, again, that's been our collaborative approach to solving these problems. And they went and looked at processes from other states. How is California addressing these growth issues? How is Colorado doing it? And they came up with this process called Envision Utah. Trying to envision, create a common vision within the communities, within the state, for a discussion about the vision for Utah's future. And I think that if you haven't done something like that in the Treasure Valley, it really is valuable. You start talking about what are the attributes of our community we like. Well, we like, you know, family style living. We've got some people that like, you know, urban core living. We want to maintain air quality. We want to maintain freedom of movement. We don't want to get gridlocked in our street system. We want to have a good balance of opportunities for transportation. Those kind of things came up. And they did a lot of visual work, too. And they said, you know, people, if you say high density, people just, no, you don't want high density. But they talked about, you know, current, they'll think about a Chicago housing project. Great. Building. Well, that's not what we're talking about these days. So what are the levels of density that help transit in a transit corridor? And it's not unattractive development. So they would do slideshows and show people these are the types of projects you could get, the types of housing, the types of business density. And if you can get that increased density in a transit corridor, you can think from a developer standpoint, well, if I have access to transit, I can get by with less number of transit stalls, so that's a lower cost for my project, and then I can charge less for rent, I can make more affordable housing. Same with a business, I can have a lower parking ratio. That way I can go higher with my building, or I can have greater density, again having greater access to the transit system. So they showed that to communities, and they had workshops all over. They had televised programs talking about what was going on, and it informed an overall plan, growth plan for the valley and what people could do. And it wasn't up to this statewide commission. They didn't have any power to push it down. It was voluntary with all the different communities. And each community did what they wanted. There's still some folks on the southwest part of the valley. We want 1 acre lots. We want 2 acre. They just, one area just went from 1 acre to 2 acre lots. And, you know, they're going the opposite direction, but they, that's the lifestyle they choose, and people still have that option to do that. They came up with planning tools as well that planners, city planners, developers, people can get into and look at different scenarios for a specific community. So if you Google Envision Utah, they still have a great website with a lot of access to a lot of those tools. And they do some consulting type work to come out to different communities and help plan. And that, I think that, you know, if you haven't done something like that, I think that's really good. It gets people speaking a common language, vocabulary about growth and plans, and it educates the population.
Question?
Yep.
Have you personally heard Rocky Anderson talk about how failure to involve the public in the first light rail downtown almost sunk the route that went up to the university they were trying to build in time for the Olympics?
Yep.
Have you heard him talk about how he had citizens in D.C. actually lobbying against
So there was a lot of opposition to the first line. There were protesters out, light rail kills babies. That wasn't a joke. They really did that. And there were a group of business owners downtown. We were right down Main Street. And they were concerned about what this was going to do to the viability of their business. And I think we learned a lot from that project. We went from building face to building face and rebuilt Main Street. Well, that was a horrendous impact to those businesses. And I think that's what he's mainly talking about. Those businesses struggled and are now, you know, some of them have turned over, and I think now they're doing pretty well. There's a lot of activity along that corridor now. But it's painful during construction. And I think we learned a lot. Steve Reed's in the back of the room. He was a project manager on the university line. So I think we took those lessons learned on that project. We were much more proactive towards the businesses. We had four South Bucks and given out, you know, funding a program where you could get some coupons to go spend in that corridor at those businesses, just to encourage people to continue to travel down there and do that project. Now, the mayor did come out one night in his bunny slippers and his jammies Steve was having the rail drug up the street. You know, there are all these little wheels, and it's just howling going up the street in the middle of the night. And he came out. He'd gotten some phone calls from residents, and he came out and had a conversation. I don't know if he greased the wheels or progress or what. So I mentioned before that a balanced transportation system can actually save money, and that plays to conservative principles, right? You want to have government be as efficient as you can, and as a total transportation package, you can look at this. So this was Envision Utah's work, the Utah Quality Growth Strategy in 99, with their scenarios. If we grew as normal, with the patterns we were, pretty auto-centric, focused on that, we were going to see infrastructure costs and $25 billion plus to the 2030. We had a more balanced system that had the transit improvements basically that you saw. So we built the 2015 program. We saved $4.5 billion. We anticipate saving $4.5 billion in infrastructure costs. And that just makes sense. If I can build a little higher density around these transit lines, that's less distance that the water lines have to move out of the core, less new additional roads and lane miles, which if I'm building out in the southwest part of the valley and people are driving into the core, it may not be just the roads out there in the southwest, but now all the roads leading into town have to be widened or improved to handle that increased traffic. So they found the vision of this. They saw that. Our chairman of our board was the speaker of the, or became the speaker of the House. He resigned from the board when he became speaker. But I went to Washington, D.C. with him, and he spoke before a House subcommittee on transportation and the value of the federal transit program. And, you know, he talked to this type of issue of how a conservative state like Utah saw the value of transit. And these are, when you go after grants for these projects, you're competing with every other project that's trying to advance around the country. So it's a very competitive project or process. Those are monies that you've all paid into through your federal gas tax. And, you know, I've had elected officials talk to me about, well, we shouldn't take that grant because we've got a federal debt. And my argument is the federal government programmed that money for that use. And if you don't take that money and bring that money back to Utah for your taxpayers, they're going to give it to Nashville or someplace else. And they're not going to put it back in the treasury against national debt. That's the program. If you want to argue about the debt and take care of the debt, take care of that. But it's like your income tax. Well, I don't take that deduction because I want to help the federal government pay down the debt. How many of you? So that, you know, that's our rationale. We want to get what's due to us. And I think we may be a little bit on the receiving end in Utah. We probably got some Idaho share. Thank you. Then you look at the corollary economic impact of these programs. So this is our new mall, City Treat Mall downtown. They took two dying malls, CCMI Mall and Crossroads Mall, and tore those down and built more of an outdoor focus, pedestrian friendly mall down there. And you've seen that kind of development along in the downtown area, and then amazing amounts of redevelopment up the 4th South line that goes up to the University of Utah. And over $7 billion of private investment in that corridor, rejuvenating that corridor, adding more housing, which is really important for us downtown to have a 24-hour population. You see so many downtowns that just, you know, 5 o'clock, downtown San Francisco, parts of that are just a ghost town. And we've got people living there now. And a lot of apartments, a lot of condos, and a lot of redevelopment. We've got a grocery store downtown. You've got to have those kind of assets, that kind of infrastructure needs to come in. And when the transit infrastructure there and the rest of the system's there to encourage downtown urban living, then the other uses. There's a lot of funding sources you could consider. Portland uses an employer payroll type tax. So everybody that comes in that gets a paycheck from within Portland, part of their paycheck is taxed. Rental car fees, parking fees, tolling, room tax, congestion pricing. London has the ring where you have to pay a higher fee if you're gonna drive into town. Some places use income taxes, transit-oriented development. You could, if we have UTA-owned property for park and ride lots, we can compress those parking lot ride lots and go vertical with the parking structure, freeze up land, but we enter into a joint venture agreement with the developers, and we contribute basically the value of our land into a joint venture, and as that project becomes profitable, what we get a percentage of the returns back. So it's an investment, and it, you're trying to use value capture, that TOD, to recoup some of the benefits that are accrued to the area. You build these transit lines, that's $7 billion of investment, increased property values, increased revenue from those developers. How do we recover some of the cost of that investment? So TOD is a strategy that we use in Utah. And special assessment districts, there's a downtown alliance in Salt Lake City where they're assessing a fee to the business owners, and they use that to help subsidize the bike share program and some of the transit enhancements downtown. You could use emission fees or vehicle mile travel type fees. And Utah's in the process now of looking at that for their overall funding for highways, because gas tax revenues aren't keeping up with vehicle miles traveled, because hybrid vehicles, electric vehicles, and just fuel economy overall is improved, so you're generating less revenue per dollar. So again, you know, some strategy for the Treasure Valley to have a dedicated funding source for transit. And however, you should have an educated discussion about what the options are.
Is it difficult?
Absolutely. Nothing's easy. You want to pay the tax yourself.
So you're diverting it from the general fund?
No, we're not. We're getting... we have a local option sales tax.
Yeah.
And for the first time this year, with new legislation that passed this year, we are getting some of the state gas tax. So that's the first time. We are now getting... This is the first... 2019 will be the first time we will get actually some state dedicated state funds. Ours has all been local... option sales tax in the individual districts and fare box.
So are you using it for new build, or are you using it for maintenance? Or
both. So we get that 0.25, we built that project, that money then pays off the debt, the bonding for that, and then pays off the ongoing operation and maintenance. And like right now, we are in an overhaul project on our oldest light rail vehicles. So we'll spend around $60 million overhauling those light rail vehicles to get another years out. So it takes, and you're going to replace rail, things like that.
Steve, can you talk a little bit about how the local options tax evolved
count, you know, the different counties, certain counties were bought into it, others didn't, and then it rose at different, increased at different increments.
Yep. That's a good point. So when we got started in 70, we had the liquor tax. So then they quickly saw they wanted to do better than that. So they enacted this local option tax. And the first cities, as you came into the district, you were assessed that quarter cent, the first quarter cent. And at first, areas came in city by city. So it was kind of hodgepodge of where service was and wasn't. And we were driving through towns that didn't pay, so we didn't stop through those cities. And then we go through the city and stop. So over time, the counties came in, Utah County came in city by city, and after a while they had a vote to unify the county and bring them in. Salt Lake came in first. Davis and Weber came in second and third. Utah County originally created their own separate transit district and then ultimately came into the overall Utah Transit Authority. And then they've had the option, as the legislature approved these different quarters, to go to a local option vote. Different counties have taken care of, taken advantage of those at different times. So we're talking about the first quarter came in when you initially came into the district. And then the second, third, and fourth quarters were all up for votes. And like right now, Davis County hasn't enacted their third quarter. They did the second, and hadn't done the third, and they're considering the fourth now. And this year, the legislature changed, and they're trying to get us, all the counties, up to an even level. And they've said, from this point on, or for a certain period of time, the counties directly, the county commissioners can directly implement that quarter cent sales tax. And that quarter cent, 40% goes to transit, 40% to city roads, 20% to county roads. So they've divvied that out a little bit. Answer your question.
Yep.
We've heard concerns about the people having different taxing rates, that it would affect the economy, that, you know, Area A has sales, higher sales tax than B, that everyone from A is going to shop in B. Have you had that experience at all with those different taxing rates?
So we get a car dealer out here in Tooele that advertised, if you'll drive 40 miles, I can save you $25. So, no. I mean, they advertise it, they talk about that. The elected officials talk about that. And I think that was the point of the legislation, was to try to get some parity across the region. Now, this is within the Wasatch Front, so you could go further north, south. You can still drive to Wendover, Nevada, or Evanston, Wyoming, if you wanted to. I don't, you know, it's small increments. We're within a quarter cent of each other right now within the Wasatch Front, so I don't think it's, if you're neglecting the cost of wear and tear on your car or your transit pass to get into that other city, it's not going to be that much different.
The other argument we get here is that it'd be just too hard for the merchants to be able to deal with the new quarter cent.
Yes. You know, they get these new things. There is a ton of power in these machines. And there's this internet thing, right? Amazon charges us in Utah because we have Amazon facilities. So somehow they figure out that I live in Bountiful, that my sales tax is different than somebody in Salt Lake, and they charge us the right amount of tax. So I think that's a fault. Not fake news, but it's not a good argument. There's the technologies here now. Back in the day when you had the little charts, you had to look, when I worked at the bookstore at the University of Idaho, and I had to look up the little charts and put in the numbers. Yeah, maybe that's a problem. Yeah.
So you mentioned improving park and ride bots,
yeah,
joint venturing. Are there any other examples you can provide?
Of value capture?
Yeah, a value capture.
Yeah. Now a community could put in, it would be like a redevelopment area, right? So you baseline the property values, and as the value of their property goes up, you get an increment of that that could come back towards the end of the distance.
And that's similar to a special assessment.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, but that's still, you're trying to capture, because you put that infrastructure in, and then the other aspect of that was a city could come in with a zoning area adjacent to that
within a reasonable different distance of that transit corridor and put a higher density zoning, so your values increase because of that. And you're going to recover that cost because you're going to be able to build a bigger project or have less infrastructure costs.
So has there been much variance in those percentages that you're receiving?
Yeah.
To try to figure out whether or not you're charging too much or too little?
I don't think I've gotten to the point where I feel like I've charged too much. But I think, you know, the developers, we're working with individual developers. We'll go out with a request for proposal, and we'll get a developer that will describe a project, and we'll select them because we think their project meets the needs of that area. Then we're into negotiation. They're developing a pro forma for a development, and you know, every development's different. It has different utility issues or permitting costs with that individual city. There's a lot of differences, and so every deal differs widely in that.
And have you seen more competition from developers over time with that?
I had 3 emails this week from developers who want to develop near or on our properties. So it's really ratcheting up. And you're seeing that right now. I don't know if it's true here. I'm seeing a lot more higher density units, apartment complexes and things here. Just in my time driving through the valley, I'm seeing a lot of that currently in the Salt Lake Valley. I think developers are having an easier time getting financing for apartment complexes. Still, there's some issue with financing for single family houses. So we seem to be seeing more and more apartments, and they're renting for amazing rents. You can get a really nice no bedroom studio apartment for $900 next door. $900 a month. And then you pay another $100 a month for your internet and cable connection. And you might pay $25 a month for your parking stall. And I don't see how people can afford that. That's amazing.
you might recall from the Super Bowl, the winning quarterback had an interview post-victory, and he talked about how he had a fear of failure. But then he recognized he learned more from failing than succeeding. And I think I hear a lot of, we don't want to fail if we go for a local option tax and waste our energy and time. Can you talk about Utah's experience going through failure and what they learned and how it ultimately it turned into something important?
So the first referendum that we did in Salt Lake County failed by 14%. We needed a simple majority, and it didn't pass. I think we learned a lot about what to tell the story. Now, our folks, the leadership at the time, were pretty crafty. They went ahead and built the project anyway. They found another way to put it together to make it work. And I'll give them all the credit in the world for that. Because once you get the first one in, you know, you want to pick the lowest hanging fruit, the best project you got to start with. Because when that one's successful, the public's going to see that. And, you know, it wasn't, how are we going to stop this project? It's when are you building my project next? You know, the city's went from, you know, barely supporting this to being raving fans. And, you know, I want you to change that alignment and make it go through my town. That kind of discussion. So now you get into a whole different kind of realm. But I think we did learn from that. We spent a lot of time talking to the transit agencies around the country who were doing similar types of projects. We toured most every light rail project in the western U.S. and almost every commuter rail project around the country just to get all the lessons learned. We had the CEOs from those commuter rail operations come to our shop and talk, show them our corridor and what would they do, what were the best practices. You don't want to fail. You do want to do. So, you know, when you go through an Envision Utah type process, it's the homework up front. We had, in our 2006, we had advertisements from the local head of UPS saying, we need these projects because my trucks need to get through traffic to deliver to passengers. Larry Miller, you know this guy, he was a great advocate for transit. He built the Jazz Stadium downtown with no dedicated parking stalls. He knew transit could help, and there was enough parking for throughout downtown to cover that. But he wouldn't, he did stand up in an ad and said, we need this. I sell cars, but we need transit. And the head of Utah Power and Light says, we need transit. One, I thought he said, you know, I think in his mind, light rail vehicles use a lot of power. Money, but he also said, my crews need to get to outages and they can't fight this traffic. So you had high-level business people, which I think you've got to find that constituent in your community. There's probably some guy at Micron that says, I'm having trouble hiring employees, get good quality employees who want to live where they want to live and work where they have to, and how do I get them to work? You know, we had Adobe relocated to Utah. They bought a company in Utah County and they relocated. And they're here at the Utah County, Salt Lake County line, and they said, we're only coming here, we're going to design our site on this rail corridor because we know you're going to extend it. When can you start extending it? We want to be LEEDS Platinum Design, which means they had to have access to at least two transit routes. So we reconfigured some routes to swing past their site. They're within a mile of our commuter rail station.
A mile?
Yeah. But we give them a bus connection.
Okay.
And some vans. Goldman Sachs relocated to downtown. And they're bringing people from all over the world here. And those people are coming from New York or Hong Kong or wherever. They want an urban environment. They want to be able to use transit to access their site. So you're going to attract a certain business interest. There's a business case to be made for this. You need those people up there advocating with you. You've got environmental concerns. You've got community development concerns. You need all those constituent groups to help participate, gather them together, and make your case to the legislature. You need to make your case to the legislature. You're going to need help in Congress, because at some point you're going to go after federal funds. And you know, for us to go to Senator Bennett or Senator Hatch and be able to have an advocate there, and they tag-teamed, and Senator Bennett won. He used to be our big advocate. And he would take us to meet with the staffers. His staffers would take us to the staffers that are rating our projects, that are taking it to Congress, that are getting it moving through the process. It always turns political at the last phase of getting these grants, and you've got to make a political push from your delegation to get the administrative folks to act and issue a grant. So you've got to have top to bottom. Your mayors, your county commissioners, your Ada County Highway District, they've got to see a way. You've got to put together a plan. And it may be like we've done lately, where you have a plan that says part of this local option tax goes to roads. Part of it may go to first and last mile type improvements like bike share, bike lanes, sidewalks. Part of it goes to transit. But you know, how you divvy up that pie to make a viable package that you can go to. And it's got to be something you can deliver, right? So we put that package together. We said, you vote for this in 2006, we'll deliver it by 2015. And we had a plan to get there.
Could you drill down on that just a little bit? Aside from opinion leaders and business leaders and political leaders, what was the basic citizen attitude towards public transit at the beginning of your journey, and what is it now? I'm talking down at the very lowest level of public attitudinal. I'm assuming you've done attitudinal surveys.
Yes, we do what we call a net promoter score. So we're surveying the public, and how do they, are you very, very supportive, somewhat supportive?
What level were you at the beginning?
Yeah. We're probably upside down.
How would you compare it to Boise, yeah, too?
And you're probably upside down. I mean, you've got a transit system that's doing the best they can with the resources they have. But you're providing a little service to a few people. We're carrying $44 million a year. You're carrying $1.2. They don't have the resources available to provide that. Now, so you have to help create a vision for this. And that's where, you know, this Envision Utah group did a great job for us. That reached out to a tremendously larger amount of the community than had ever been involved before, because everybody cared about growth. what was our community going to be like? So that started creating a common vocabulary. It was all over the papers. It was on TV. It was talked about a lot. And that helped create a basis for a vision. And then, you know, so then you've got the mayors and electeds that are starting to talk about this, starting to catch the vision. We did a lot of trips with elected officials to other cities to get that going. The chamber would bring business owners to Portland or wherever to see what we had, and we built that up over time. That first project, they voted down the referendum that would have funded it. We started to find a way to fund it. The general manager was charged with racketeering. Right? They went hard after him. They were filing a lawsuit to stop the project. They fought through that and worked it. But again, once you got the first one, it was Katie bar the door. I mean, it just turned around. And do most people think that UTA, the transit system, adds value to their community? I think you'd say yes. Our data shows that that's turned around. I think you're at that beginning stage here, because a lot of people don't have exposure to it. You've got a lot of people who moved in from other places that have a transit system. You ought to be able to bring some of that to bear.
Problem in Idaho right now is local option tax is not allowed.
Correct.
Except in resort communities. I don't ignore that. It's only allowed in McCall, Haley, Ketchum. But Boise does not allow. And so it's a law that would have to be passed at the state legislature. It keeps getting turned down. And part of that is some of the leadership. You have Mike Moyle, who lives out here in West Haley County, in Star. And his response to me when I proposed it to him is, why don't we have local option tax? I grew up here in Boise, in this area, and then lived all over the country, Detroit, Houston, large metropolitan areas, moved back here, no local option tax. I don't want to drive to Boise and pay an extra quarter of a cent sales tax to support that rail system or bus system. So it's that parochial attitude that has to change, is, you know, pushing your local legislator to support local option taxing statewide and not just in the resort cities.
So it takes that broad base, right? You can't just hire a lobbyist to do it. Those folks have to hear from you to get the right, you know, talk to your legislators and say, you know, this is a good choice. We're willing to do this. We need to do this. The planning compass needs to show plans and show that. Your challenge now with your long-range plan, you can only show long-range plans based on your funding assumptions. Well, you don't have the ability for local option sales tax, so your funding options are down here instead of where they would be if you had that option available to you. So you're constrained. You look at your 2040 plan, your 2040 plan, it's pretty limited, I just said. You don't have enough transit in here, but we can't put it in the plan. You've got to follow the rules. So this is critical. This is your big deal. This is your opportunity to really, you know, if you support this, this is your opportunity to make a change here. If it's going, it's time. If you look at Salt Lake's growth versus Boise, you're about 30 years behind us. And you think about how long it took us to get that first line and get a program and get things going. 30 years. Think of where this valley is going to be in 30 years. What are your options going to be if we don't start planning now for that future? What's the future you want to see for the Treasure Valley?
Well, most of their population is in that valley. That's not quite the situation here.
Everybody's different.
So how do you convince those people up like in Coeur d'Alene or Eastern Park?
They don't have that. Well, yeah, they. But what you're saying, you know, think about if Congress passes something, how do the state legislators feel? But then the state legislators won't let you decide. You ultimately are going to get a vote. They just have to enable it to happen. Whether Coeur d'Alene does it or not, that's Coeur d'Alene's residents' decision. But what you're asking for is some self-determination from the legislature, right? You're trying to get the ability to dictate what happens in your community. And
don't know how to get there.
Basically, they don't want their community to have the right to raise taxes, to have self-determination. And since they don't want it for their community, they're not going to get your voice.
Yeah. Well, it always seems like the level of government that thinks they're the right ones to make the decisions hates anybody above them that makes the decision, right? But they don't think the level below them has enough knowledge or smarts. That, yeah, it's a challenging situation. What I would suggest is maybe you need to, we can help you find some legislators in Idaho that would be, or in Utah, that would be willing to talk and see some of the strategies that they came up with. You can talk to some Vision Utah group and see how they put together the programs and start to build that support.
Well, I just am wondering if anyone knows, is there a group in Idaho that is getting organized and working towards this, like at Vision Utah? Does anyone know?
Maybe.
Is there any? I don't know who is
seeking. I'm good here.
Broad vision, like envisioning a light rail in our valley.
Compass is planning for passenger rail, but as you said right now, it's unfunded. It shows it as unfunded in our long range plan. We're planning for the extent we can. There's only so much we can do because, as you said, because we're what's called fiscally constrained. We can only go so far without being able to show that we can pay for it. So we are planning for it, but we can only go so far. We are also working hard to try to get local option taxing authority. But again, having a broad-based public support is huge because as an organization and our members, we only do so much. But we are, it is something that we're planning on and planning for, but without funding, there's only so far we can go.
Okay.
So it's a chicken and egg kind of thing, right?
Yeah.
So, you know what? Some areas have done, they said, you know, if we could design a future of how we would want, you know, what would be the ultimate far end of the transit-centric side? Because I think you've got the highway-centric side. You don't have a lot of transit. So, you know, there could put together some funding packages, everybody contribute to getting that study done and showing what that future, what those futures look like. It is going to take some money. Envision Utah, they got annual appropriations from the governor. The governor thought it was a good idea, right? The governor formed this initial group during the recession and tried to get that going. It caught fire, you know, he had a coalition, he had some business leaders that wanted to do this, some citizens groups that wanted to do that. It's going to take all of you. This Compass is just made up, you know, they're representative of the cities and counties and districts that you're part of. They're the elected officials. They need your help to make that happen.
So what was your, oh, excuse me.
Do you have a comment?
Who founded Envision Utah?
Legislature kicked off with some initial funding from that. And then as smaller entities wanted work done, they come up with money to try to do that.
Given that it's an election year, do you have any experience or any recommendations for talking about like getting involved in state legislature or politicians? You know, we're about to see a turnover in the governorship. We're going to see probably some turnover in the state legislature. Is this a particularly good time to start poking at those local option issues, or is it a particularly bad time, or do you have any comment on that?
It's probably a little late.
Okay.
You know, have you had your primary yet?
Yeah.
So you know, they're where they're at. What they need to hear is from voters who say, this is important to me. What's your position on that? Start with, what's your position on that? This is important to me, and I think to my community. What's your position on that? Try to get politicians are flexible, but if they hear it's important to the people, they're there to represent you. And how this is an issue that can't wait. I mean, my mom has a house at Meridian and Chinden, down there, the really nice farmland right next to where last year is now
plowed up with the next phase of Paramount.
It's great.
But are we doing what we need to do to plan? Is that, is Ada County Highway District thinking about Chinden needs to be a certain width to accommodate some certain amount of transit?
Let's do a two-lane pass Eagle Road. It's absurd.
Amanda, she had a question about it.
Me?
Yeah.
Can you tell us what your plan B was? What was your alternate funding and what broke the ice on your project?
So when the referendum failed, we had some, the company had some reserves and they had bonding capability with the existing funding that they had. And they got the board to approve that. They went forward with the project. It was a risk because if ultimately those follow-on sales tax increase hadn't happened, we probably would have had to cut some of the bus service though. Continue to fund the rail. So, yeah, it's not easy. It's not a desirable position to be the head of a transit agency. When that major change happened, there was a new general manager for the agency shortly after that. He took that risk, but his Kevlar jacket only takes so many hits to it, and he went. And right after the next referendum, that general manager left. So, It's a politically sensitive job.
I know in the Radiant Chamber we've talked a lot about what we're going to do with transportation and working with the legislators, and we are at that spot. We've got, ITD has, they say, over $500 million worth of projects on the books, and they've only got a little over $100 million to spend. Yeah. And we're trying to do something with Chinden, and all we can get authorized is a mile. And we got the residents in the Northwest community, and I get it, are opposed to further development in that area, so it's really hard to get a consensus. But it is going to take us, you know, my question, I got two questions. One is, that pie chart you showed early on, was that, as far as funding, was that for operating or development and operating?
Both. Okay. So when we get a sales tax increase, it's typically a focus for some projects. So we're building those projects, and then that same stream pays off the debt and covers ongoing operations. So you have to take that all into consideration. You got to maintain a state of good repair of your system.
It really is going to take local option, because if you think about it, you've got all of our rural communities, council and all over the state, and they're not wanting to see what they call the city of Ada or the state of Ada. They don't want to see this area gobble up state funds, and so that's where we've got to go with our legislature and say, okay, give us a way to invest in this. And then there's got to be, I mean, right now bonding requires a supermajority
and a dedicated funding source.
Yeah, and we have a hard time getting that done for schools, let alone transportation. Mm-hmm. So it really does take some real awareness from all of us.
So think back to the Garvey bond program. That passed, right? That got approved. Why did it? It had something for everybody,
right?
So think about a strategy where you say, okay, we want maybe not a quarter cent, but we want to go for a half cent, but we want to dedicate some of that to roads. And, you know, if Coeur d'Alene said, well, we need roads, we'll pass it. And it allows flexibility in how that's, if you have a transit district, a certain percentage has to go to transit. If you don't have a transit district, you can either create one. If you create one at some point, they get a portion of that money, but if they don't, they could all go to roads. So some, if they vote for it, if they choose to have some local funds for their development of their infrastructure, they could choose, the communities could choose. Maybe eliminate, you know, you got to get out there and find out what the barriers are to approval, right? Why isn't the state authorizing communities to tax them? They don't like transit. Well, come on the bus, bring them down, we'll take them around. Show them what it can do.
How important is it in this kind of climate to show incremental improvements in existing public transit as laying the base for the ultimate goal? Or do we simply sit back and allow the disaster to happen? And I'm not arguing the costs and the fees. I'm just saying,
getting back to attitudinal. Is it in a community where support for public transit is pretty minimal to begin with, it's going to be an awful big leap to get to the goals, the situation that you've gotten to. So do we get to that point through incremental improvements, trying to build the public support, or do we just allow the inevitable to happen and then deal with it?
I think your challenge to come up with the incremental improvements. Right? Where's your funding going to come? You're going to go to each city and say, give me a little bit more next year so I can do a little bit more. Well, it's coming out of the same funding sources as the police and the fire department. How do you choose? You put, you know, they're in a tough spot. Whereas if you can create, and it's the same issue in Salt Lake. We had to come up with a dedicated funding source. You wait for the disaster to occur, it costs you so much more to build. You know, if you don't get the street, you know, you don't identify Fairview and Cherry Lane as the corridor you want to go down. And Cherry Lane gets built narrow and can't do that, so you have to go back and buy a row of houses on the side of the street. You know, you just set yourself up. We finally, this year, got money for corridor preservation, for transit. Before, you couldn't use corridor preservation funds, and the state has set aside corridor preservation funds. We couldn't preserve corridor using state funds. Now we have access to that. That's huge. To go in and buy that when it's a farmer's field versus when it's a row of houses, you're saving the taxpayer money. You know, and you've got to look at all these things that you're doing that gives value. Back to that, you've got to do something that gets them in their wallet that says, this overall program allows us to grow. Horseshoe Bend, you don't want to be a sprawl city or whatever. Well, we can grow in Ada County, Canyon County, accommodate that growth here. We can preserve farmland. We don't have to go wall-to-wall houses. We can have some green belt. So you got to figure out how to make the case. What are your leaders looking at? What's the barrier to them moving forward with this? And how do you tap it? Chambers are critically important. The Salt Lake Chamber, the tremendous force for the there, the Jedis with the blue and the green thing. And they were out there leading out. And that is so powerful. Elected officials are going to listen to business leaders. So you've got a lot of investment here from the Larry Miller group. There's still leaders within that company, I think, that would speak out and talk about the benefits. Cam Gardner is a big developer in Boise. He was a big developer in Salt Lake. So there are folks that have connections to these other communities where they've seen transit work that they can be, you know, strong advocates for. I'm gonna go to, okay. So we talk about sustainable transit. It's great getting that first project in. It's great getting those rail lines in. Our real focus at UTA now is some of the rest of this strategy. We need you can't forget about the feeder buses that feed these rail lines. They get you from your, what we call the first mile and last mile. You've got to have the sidewalk improvements. You got to, bike share has been a great thing for us to make those connections in transit. Complete streets where you've got accessible, you know, routes for walking and biking. You got to look at when you're approving these subdivisions, you get that quarter or half mile long fence against the major street. It needs some breaks in there so the pedestrians can get to a bus stop so they don't have to walk 3/4 of a mile around to get to the major corridor to get to the bus stop. So we think, you know, as we look at things that will help us with ridership, expanding transit is a big thing. Smart transit-oriented growth around these corridors can be a big increment to the benefit of everybody. Getting the people living here, working here, they have better access to transit. Congestion pricing may be a strategy that we talked about implementing. We're talking about raising the fee on our HOV lanes and some things like that. And then these bike and pedestrian improvements. Again, they talk about the coalition of supporters. You know, how can we get
our public, our engineers and planners to think outside the box, to think about what these scenarios would be with different funding strategies. Get beyond that. Start creating a plan that shows how we could make this happen. Take the shackles off and let them go. And then, so we need some visionary planning without some of the constraints. What would be a reasonable amount of local option sales tax, and what would be the plans? Getting the, maybe it's some of these private business leaders contributing to get into that and make that happen. Maybe it's putting together informational packets for residents and for other business leaders to say that this is something we need. The time is now, and we need to get looking at it. So, and I think the Envision Utah type thing where we looked at growth scenarios and benefits really paid off. It was a multi-year effort, but it really informed the conversation. And then you had, you know, you've got the past influencing the future, and that's Utah, it's all root beer. But you need to create your transportation future. Right? Those guys started it. We had a letter come in, I don't know if it was Doug or not, but they said, back in the 1860s, they laid 10 mile of rail a day. Commuter rail is 40 miles long. You should be done with that in a week. And I said, have you seen that rail out there? I mean, it was not in good shape. That first train barely made it on the track before they started rebuilding. Ours is lasting a lot. Other questions?
What did you connect with that first project that was so persuasive?
We hit some of the most populated suburb communities. And we had, in Sandy, we had a very visionary mayor that was kind of a spokesperson. He ended up being the chairman of the Wasatch Front Regional Council, RMPO. He was the head of the council of mayors. He was a thought leader. And he created at the south end of the valley a new downtown. He wanted to be, they call their area, Sandy, they call it base camp. Creating this area where it's access to the four ski resorts along the Wasatch Front. And he set the tone. They got zoning where they can build real buildings down there. And he's got connections from light rail to commuter rail, working with them on circulators. We now have Salt Lake City, who was allowed to increase their sales tax by another half cent. So they're going to be a half cent higher than everybody else because they got the opportunity to have a prison in their town. The state prison moved out of the suburb to out past the airport. So because they got the prison, they get another bonus half cent sales tax. And they're choosing to give us give UTA millions of dollars a year for service within the city. More frequency of service, hours of service, and frequency of service because they want their residents to be able to have access to better transit within the city, not let alone, you know, the city, the population of the city almost doubles during the day because people commuting in the town.
Do you have any criminal incidents at all on these trains?
I am not in charge. So we had any crime on the train? Yes.
Has there been, you know,
yes.
There was a big one in Portland a while back.
Yes, we haven't had any stabbings, I don't think. But we have bad behavior. We have a free fare zone in downtown that went right past our homeless shelter. So there was a fair amount of commerce that was occurring on the train. we had our own police force, and we work really well with the police in the different communities. So we work on it really hard. It's important to have a safe facility. And we have a lot of cameras. I think we have 1,800 cameras on our system. Every vehicle has cameras on it.
Can you talk about the land use that around the stations for both commuter rail and light rail, and the timing in which the local agencies were developing or coordinating their land use plans? How much of it was chicken and egg? Or how much was it really agencies being really prepared for those?
Yeah. It's last part. First, it was really chicken and egg. Right. So we built, some communities got it more than others. Some tried it, and it's worked out pretty well. Now it seems like it's the common thing. We're rezoning around our transit stations. When we built the lines, we signed an agreement that said, let us build rail in a rail corridor. We don't have to go to each city and get a permit. And they agreed to that. We said, we will go to your community when we have a park and ride, when we have a station and a park and ride lot, we will go through your zoning approval process. That cost us some time and some grief and a lot of late evenings with planning commissions and city councils, but it was worth it because the community got a station that had the look and feel for that community. And everybody wanted something a little bit different, and we tried to frame it where it wouldn't blow our budget, but they could have some individuality of what they wanted. Then with the development, I think our stepping out and being a leader in the TOD world, the cities were willing to take a chance around our stations with us and our property because we had a shared vested interest in the success. Now developers are doing that on their own. They're going, I want to locate here. I want these zoning concessions. I want to have higher or lower parking ratios. I want higher density. I'm perhaps going to enter into a pass program with the employees in this building so that we can increase transit use. And now we can demonstrate that. We can demonstrate it to the lenders. That was the hardest part, getting the banks on board. We're going to build next to a transit station and have a lower infrastructure cost. We're going to build less parking. They're saying, no, you've got to build more parking. They're saying, no, we don't want you unless you're going to build less parking. We had a call center come in. A normal commercial or office building might be 3 or 4 stalls per 1,000. They went to a call center, they went to 8 stalls per 1,000. They said, you don't want to be on our property. We love you. We think you're a huge transit, so we don't think you need as many stalls. But until you're convinced, go someplace else. So it's really come a long way. You come to Salt Lake and you look at this road that goes up to the university, and there's probably 2,000 apartment units that have gone in along that corridor. It's changed from traditional strip commercial to a lot of neighborhood commercial. It's an active, vibrant community along there, and a big part of that is because they have access to that light rail.
What do you think future mass transit going to look like with autonomous vehicles and what have you?
That's a great question. What's autonomous vehicles going to do for us? At some point, we'll have a self-driving bus. I don't know how the person in a wheelchair gets boarded in that or how you address some of the issues. Maybe it's just a bus host that's in there that helps with information and some of that. But I think there's more and more autonomous information. We've had sensors on our buses that tell us when somebody's getting close in your blind spot, you know, like you have from some of your cars. So there's more and more technology that's going in there. There's autonomous train systems now. Most of those are in dedicated corridors that are grade separated. So I think, you know, as the technology evolves, there's opportunity there. We have an innovative mobility group within our company that is looking at issues like that. You know, maybe it's for the first and last mile, maybe there's autonomous cars parked at our stations that can get you to your work, things like that. So we're looking at, you know, we have an app now that you can put in your origin, where you're at and where you're going to, and it'll give you all the transit options. Well, we want to expand that. Give me a Uber option on there. Let me put in how much I want to spend on this trip and tell me what my options are for that. Maybe I can't afford an Uber, but if I take an extra bus route, so there's a lot on the technology side. We can do a lot better communicating. We're going to have our bus rapid transit system. We're going to have real-time information with a map that shows in real-time where the buses are on the system. They'll know exactly where that bus is away from it. Because that uncertainty, you go to a bus stop, and you're standing there. There's nobody else there. You go, did I just miss the bus? Was it going fast today? Or is it still coming? Where is it? Well, now I have an app with our system on it. I can see where on the street that bus is in real time. And that takes that uncertainty away.
We were in San Diego in December, and it was like that. Yeah. I mean, the text number is right there on the sign. You punch it in, and it tells you when the next bus is going to be there. And we've got a younger generation today that is running the numbers on whether or not they want to own a car.
Right. Yeah, we're seeing a lot of that. And if you can have Wi-Fi on the vehicle and you can watch a cat video?
Why rail? Why, what can be covered by buses?